So Patrick, what are the first things that you do when you arrive on set as a cameraman or a DP? Can you take us through how you're scouting the location, how you're envisioning setting up shots?
Mm. Yeah, I mean, when I start a film, I don't do a lot of shooting at first. I spend quite a bit of time with with our subjects and with the story, and I leave the camera in the bag. So I may spend several days or longer, maybe a week, just getting to know our subjects and allowing them to get a chance to know us. So that's sort of the first thing we do. And I've been shooting for 25 years now. So, you know, and I shoot most of our own work. Although on If You Build It, we had a really talented DP named George Desort, who also did a lot of shooting with us. I look for the light, honestly, not to sound too artsy fartsy, but I don't like to use lights when we're shooting, because I think lighting on the set of a documentary is pretty unnatural. So, we look for where is there enough light to shoot the story? We don't shoot the story very often at night if we can avoid it. Once we kind of have our bearings and understand the locations and understand the stories, then we start shooting.
I find that interesting that you say you leave the camera out and you meet with the, quote, subjects a few times. Once that camera's out, does everything just change? We were talking about off camera for a moment, just how it just changes like the whole dynamic of the room almost.
Yeah, no, I mean, that's a great question about how does the camera affect your subjects? And it's a question that I think about a lot. Because for our films, we always want to try to get as close to the story as we can without changing the story. And so that's too hard to do when you have a camera in a room, whether you're making a movie or whether you're just taking pictures at a birthday party. I mean, cameras tend to affect people. They act a little differently when they're around. That said, we spend a lot of time with our subjects, and I think after a while they just get used to the camera being in the room, and it starts to feel, I think, pretty natural to them. We did something on If You Build It that we had never done before, which is we put cameras into the hands of the kids that we were telling the story about. So we asked them to shoot for us when we weren't there, and even to shoot while we were there. They were always shooting flip cams or iPhones, and a lot of that footage is in the movie. And that was great too, because I think it allowed them to understand what we do, and also to sort of demystify the process of making a film. Nowadays, everyone's a filmmaker. And we started a film festival here at our local grammar school where literally like first and second grade kids make their own movies and show them in the film festival. So this idea of filmmaking it's so broad now, and so many people, I think, take part in that it's really been interesting to watch that. There's just some great stories being made nowadays by people who never really traditionally have been thought of as filmmakers.
Following up with this hypothetical subject, when you do bring the camera out, let's say you've met with them three mm-hmm. times and you've built a rapport and there's a level of trust there, but you notice that they've changed a little in front of the camera. Maybe they're super on, maybe they're second guessing themselves. How do you get them, and this is a horrible terminology, but I can think of no other, verbal diarrhea, just get it out of them. And I know that's really just...
How do you
get it out of them? Yeah.
How do you get that actingness out of them, sort of that performance?
Or nervousness, or whatever it is, because you're trying to get to that sort of
core
of who they are, and everybody has their own way of acting once that camera first comes out. And again, that's a horrible term.
I would say that that is a bit of a challenge when you've traveled halfway around the world, let's say, to spend time with somebody, and they're not being themselves on camera. They're acting or performing. That happens. As hard as you try for it not to happen.
Are there any tricks you do?
You know, one thing that helps, I think, that I find helps quite a bit is, I really feel like, you know, asking the same question to them repeatedly. So you ask them a question, you know, why do you do what you do? And you get an answer. And then an hour later, why do you do what you do? Why do you do what you do? And you keep asking them. Eventually, you're gonna wear them down, and they're gonna stop putting on a show, because it's hard to put on a show in front of the camera. I mean, it really gets sort of tiring. We've had shoots where we had the camera. I've had the camera in my hand where I wasn't even rolling, because I knew we're not really getting anything, so I just stopped rolling, because there's no reason to bring all this footage back that we're not going to use. And then once I feel like they've kind of let their guard down and they're being themselves more, then we start rolling. So yeah, I mean, there's a lot of, when I was younger, I spent some time in front of the camera and I did some acting and really enjoyed it when I was a little kid. And so I definitely have spent time in front of the camera, and I understand the fact that it's an unnatural place to be, and people can get a little nervous in front of the camera. So we just do the best we can to take the mystery out of it and to try to allow people to just act themselves. And you know, it's funny, something happened on our most recent film on If You Build It. It never had happened before, but it was just, I'd never heard this before, but it was something I'll never forget. One of the subjects in our film is a guy named Matt Miller, and he's an architect and a teacher in our film. And his mom lives very far away from him. I think she's like 2,000 miles away from where he lives, and they don't see each other that often. But she told me that we gave her a copy of the film, and she told me that a lot of times she'll watch the movie just to be around him. And she feels like our movie is Matt. I mean, that's how she described it, that our movie really just captured who he is. And that when the movie is on, sometimes you'll turn the volume down, but she feels like she's around him. I mean, that to us is what we're trying to achieve. We want to tell great stories, but we don't want to change our subjects to do that. I think there's great stories in real life. And if you're patient enough, you know, you can really capture those stories without changing them.
Do you think a documentary filmmaker should have 100% creative control? Mm. You talked about earlier this person, Matt, in your film, mm-hmm. and the mom watched it and she was delighted because that was Matt, raw,
right.
That was him.
Right.
But there gets to be a time when certain subjects, mm-hmm. well-meaning, well-intentioned, don't like certain things that are said, don't like the way they look, don't like the way they're portrayed.
Yeah.
In the end, in the beginning probably, what are your boundaries? What do you tell them?
Yeah, no, it's a great question. I feel very strongly that the filmmaker or filmmakers really have to have final cut in the film, and for a lot of reasons. It's really hard to make one of these with a committee. You can do it, but I think you're going to end up with something that's really watered down and not very good. So I think having a really clear vision, who's telling the story and how do they want to tell the story is really, really important. And we always demand final cut with our films, you know, of our partners and our subjects. And we will not do a film unless we have that. But that said, the kinds of films that we tell, you know, I don't consider myself an investigative journalist, for example. I'm not typically trying to uncover deceitful activity or catch people in a lie or catch people doing things that they shouldn't be doing. The stories we tend to tell, are not like that. That's not the kind of stories we're drawn to. But we do invite feedback from our subjects. We do want to know, first of all, if the story is accurate and if we've made any mistakes or factual mistakes. And also, you know what? In order to get 100% trust and confidence from your subjects while you're making your film, I think they need to know that they could raise a red flag before the film gets released. There may be something that we've captured that we didn't even realize we had captured, that for whatever reason to them, it would be very painful if that got out or would create a real problem for them. And we have taken feedback from people. And, you know, there are many cases where we have allowed that sort of input to affect our final cut. But all that aside, we don't do puff pieces, and we don't do like PR films. I mean, we do films that try to capture the real story. In If You Build It, for instance, Emily and Matt, who are the two teachers that are in the film, I mean, they went through a really difficult time together. They were not getting along that well together. There were some people in the town, especially the school board, that were very unsupportive. All of that is in the film. And you know, no one who's familiar with the story thinks that we tried to gloss it over. I mean, there's a lot of conflict in the film. So, you know, if someone says to me, I don't like how I look there, I don't like what I said there, if it rings true to us, and there isn't a real compelling reason not to include it, we leave it in the film. And I have to say, we've had really great relationships with the people we've worked with. All the way down the line. I mean, like Will Shortz from Wordplay, David Walker, the Comptroller General of the United States, who we did IOUSA with, Matt and Emily and the students from If You Build It. I mean, those people are all, I think they're all really proud of the films that we made about them because they're accurate and they're really compelling and they're even entertaining. So I think that's important. Now, if you're, let's say you're Michael Moore or any number of investors, Alex Gibney, any number, Joe Berlinger, of investigative journalists, that's not going to be the case because they're uncovering a lot of things that make people look bad. And I mean, they're good at doing that and they're doing it for all the right reasons. Mm. So obviously they probably play by a different set of rules. And I think we would probably play by a much different set of rules when we decide to tell a story like that, which I'm sure we'll do at some point in the future.
So what's your talk like with these people, or is it in a contract? I mean, how do you lay those ground rules out, probably from the beginning, right?
Yeah.
Because you really want to get off on that right foot.
Yeah, no, I really try to stay away from contracts.
Makes
and a lot
scared.
Of legal documentation. I mean, that right away gets people suspicious, like what am I getting into here. We just talk to people, we look them in the eye and we tell them, this is what we're going to do. We think you're really interesting, we think you have a great story, we want to make a film about you. It's a film that we're going to make about you. We value your input, we'll certainly listen to your input, but at the end of the day, it's our movie that we're making about you. And if you don't want to go along on the ride, then tell us now. Again, I think the easiest thing, at least for us, is people look at our work and they know that we don't throw people under the bus unless they deserve it. The people of the school board of Bertie County, North Carolina, comes off looking pretty bad in our film, and rightly so. In fact, I think some people have told us that we maybe let them off a little too easily. But if you're going to spend a year or two with someone and you're going to devote a big part of your life to telling their story, and you're also going to take their story and bring it to a really wide audience, I mean, that's a pretty important conversation that you have to have, and you have to really develop some trust between each other that you're going to do this together and that it'll be something that you'll all be proud of when it's all done.
Patrick, what's the reason you don't edit your own films?
Well, I actually do quite a bit of editing. On Wordplay, I did a lot of editing on that film. That was our first film. I've done less and less as we move forward. When we were making Wordplay, that was our first film, and really the only disagreement that my wife Christine and I had about the making of that film was I said, you know, I'd like to just edit it because I know how to edit. It'll save us a lot of money and let's do it. And she said, no. She said, we got to bring in a fresh set of eyes. And I remember thinking, okay, fine. We'll hire an editor. We'll have to raise more money. But, you know, I'm sure my friend Doug Blush is not available because he's never available because he's always working. But I'll call him and see if he can recommend somebody. I called him. He was available. And that made all the difference in the world. I mean, you really, because I shoot my own footage, I'm really close to the material already. But I think you end up with a better film if you have another set of eyes, a very, you know, creative individual like Doug. Doug Blush is just a spectacularly talented editor. And, you know, I learned a lot there. He saw things in the footage that I would have never seen. So, you know, that was an important decision for us.
Like what? I'm just curious, what examples? Like, were there certain details that you overlooked maybe that he, it was like a light bulb went off?
Well, I mean, Doug is really funny and really smart. He's got a great sense of humor. And so, for instance, in Wordplay, you know, we had all these different characters who are somehow involved with the New York Times crossword puzzle. You know, either they make the puzzle or they are really good at solving it, or they're, we had a lot of sort of famous people in the film who liked the puzzle quite a bit. So Doug just had a great ability to take one character and put it right next to another character and another character. He had a great way of sort of lining up the film. And so, for instance, there was a scene in the movie where we're interviewing Jon Stewart. And Jon Stewart, I mean, he was great. He was just really funny, not surprisingly. And he says in his interview, he says, you know, he's holding the puzzle in his hand and he says, you know, I have tremendous respect for people who make these puzzles. I don't know how they do it. Quite frankly, I don't know why they do it. And then that's where Doug cut to Merle Regal, who's a very famous crossword puzzle constructor. He's driving down the street and he says, oh yeah, look at that sign there, Dunkin' Donuts. Put the D at the end, you have unkind donuts, which I've had a few of in my day. Like, that's a 1 + 1 = 3. That is such a good cut. I would have never thought to do that. And, you know, that's what a great editor does. I mean, they're great. They're not just great on story. They're also great on transitions, getting in and out of scenes. And it's really terrific. Doug has been a wonderful collaborator with us on all of our work.
And what about the times when you think a scene or a statement should be there, and then that editor says, you know what, that's beating them over the head with it? Or were there times when he tried to rein you in with certain things, or was it mostly little fine details that?
I mean, our rule here is the best idea wins. And usually the best idea, it's very, very plain to see. Like, what's the best way to cut a scene? What's the best way to cut an act? What music cue works? What music cue isn't working, etc. And so, yeah, we don't have that many disagreements, honestly. I was really lucky to work with a really talented younger editor. Doug's pretty young too, but younger than Doug. A guy named Nick Andert, and we hired him pretty much like right out of college. And he started as an assistant editor, and then he basically moved up. He became kind of the primary editor of If You Build It. And, you know, Nick has a great eye, and he's got a great ear. And I think the only things I would encourage Nick to do was to maybe slow down the edit a little bit. A lot of the things he cut were really pretty tight and efficient, possibly maybe a little too efficient. And so I found that I would oftentimes ask him to maybe slow some things down a little bit. But again, Nick is a lot like Doug. Nick is just a tremendous storyteller and was really like a key part of our team on this film. I mean, it's really, I think it's as much Nick's film as it is our film. He spent over a year editing the film. And so I think he's flying that helicopter too.
he's making sure that you say everything right.
And so, you know, he just did a great job. We've been very lucky to find good editors with our work.
Do you think that quick edit is a sort of a generational thing?
I do.
Because I'm noticing for myself, being a little bit older, I like things that are slower paced. Maybe not Dinner with Andre slow paced,
right.
But good movie, excellent. But still, just a little slower. Whereas I see a lot of newer things with younger editors much faster. And I was just wondering if it's an age thing.
I think that is the case. I really do. You know, and I'm talking a second here, a second there, 5 seconds here. You know, he's really good. Nick is very, very good. It's annoying how good he is for his age.
We'll still be nice to him.
Yeah, no, I mean, he's really talented. I think I'm a good collaborator. I certainly try to be. And the one thing about working with editors on our films is that, like I said, like, most of the footage I've shot myself. And as I'm shooting it, I take, you know, notes every day at the end of a shoot. I call them my field notes. And I just write down the handful of sound bites, the handful of images, the handful of ideas that I think we're going to use in the film, or we'll try to use. I mean, we try to sift the story as we're making it. And so, you know, there are times with any editor, where you're like, you know, there's something in there that I think we're missing. I want you to just see if you can find this one soundbite or this one shot or something. But I, you know, more often than not, whether it's Doug or Nick, we work with an editor named Daniel Clark, who's terrific. They've seen it, they considered it, and then they realized it wasn't right for the scene. And actually, usually they're right. So it's fun. I mean, the editing is, I think editing is filmmaking. You know, as a cameraman, I don't know, I just always thought that, you know, when you make a movie, it's grab a camera and go shoot it. And obviously you have to have that. But if it's not well cut, it's not going to work. I mean, for our movies, you have to take 100 or 200 hours of footage and make an 85-minute film. That's really hard to do. But that's just... That's it. That's really where I think the most important work is done.
So this question we can not use if you don't want me to. Sure. I'm going to just say it now. So
go for it.
Did wordplay make you a millionaire?
No. No, wordplay did not make us a millionaire. It's funny you should ask that, because when we that was our first film. And we took it to, we got accepted to Sundance in 2006, took it to the festival, and there was a very intense bidding war for that film. We ended up with seven offers on the table from, you know, all the big distributors. And we sold it for $1 million. We had only spent a little over $100,000 to get the movie to Sundance. Okay, so we spent a year making it. We spent about $100,000 and change to make that cut of the film. And we sold it for $1 million. And I remember telling our agent at Sundance, our agent is John Sloss from Cinetic Media. I said, I'm really worried about selling our film for $1 million. I'm afraid that, you know, we're gonna be one of those infamous films that come out of Sundance, like, oh, they paid too much and that movie underperformed. And like, I didn't want to have all that. I was like, we should sell it for less. He's like, no. He's like, first of all, $1 million is not that much money for a movie. He's like, you've made a really good film that a lot of people want to see. So that's the right price. And you know, and you have it. It's we already have a deal. We already shook hands on this deal. What I didn't know was that when after Sundance, you know, Sundance is in January, and we were in theaters, we were in about 500 theaters that summer in June. We came out in June later on that year. We had a lot of work to do on the film between selling it and releasing it. We had to film out. We had to pay for that. It was $100,000, over $100,000 to film out. We had to license all the music. We did a lot more graphics. We did a lot more editing. It really started to add up. And by the time we were sitting in the theaters on opening night at the IFC Center in New York City, we had spent a total of almost $700,000. So do the math. We walked away with $300,000. Now that's great. I mean, if I could do that every year, I would do that every year. Unfortunately, that's not what normally happens. I think on a lot of these films, I mean, I hate to say it because it sounds really discouraging, but I think on a lot of these documentaries, you're lucky even to break even. And what we're finding nowadays is that if you don't have good partners when you go out to make these films, you're really going to be in trouble. On this film, we had, on If You Build It, we had great partners. The Sundance was a big partner. The John D. and Catherine T. MacArthur Foundation, Film Independent, the Candida Foundation, which is out of the East Coast, the Wincote Foundation. We did a Kickstarter campaign. We won an Independent Spirit Award. We won the Bright Future Award presented by Unilever Project Sunlight. That was a $25,000 award that we won. I mean, we had an army behind us, really, to make this film. If we didn't have that, we probably wouldn't be sitting here in my house because we probably would have lost our house. We probably would have had to sell our house. I mean, it was so financially challenging for us to make this film. Christine and I and our partner Neil Baer, you know, we've been at this a long time. We've been making movies, and Neil's a tremendously successful television writer and showrunner. And we thought we had it all figured out. And then we made this movie about a small town in North Carolina that took 3 years to make, and it was hard to raise money. I mean, it was challenging. So, you know, wordplay was great. And we made money on that film. And we also sort of launched our film careers at the same time. But I think more often than not, these movies, you do them for other than financial reasons. And if you are lucky enough to make money on a film, more often than not, you fold that into your next project and it's tied up in the next one. So yeah, it's great. If anyone is thinking about like becoming a millionaire, I wouldn't recommend making documentary films because it's very unusual that would be the case. It could happen, but more often than not, it won't.
So knowing that there were some times when you could have come close to losing many things, how did you get through that? Were there sleepless nights? Were there times when you really had to just go for a walk around the block and say, okay, what's my focus? Why am I doing this?
Well, we started making If You Build It in summer of 2010. We were hoping to be done, to have the movie out there at festivals in early 2012. It took a year longer than we thought. So throughout all of 2012, we were still making the movie. We weren't, you know, releasing it and putting it out in the world. So yeah, it was an extra 12 months that we had not planned on, we had not budgeted for. The story kept going. The editing was harder than we thought it would be because the story was really fairly complex and there were a lot of nuances that took a long time to figure out. And so we spent all of 2012 on this film and we didn't make any money at all, not a penny. We were trying to raise money and we were trying to get other partners, but that had stalled. So it was tough. I mean, that was tough. But you know, we got through it and called in a lot of favors, and luckily there was a very happy ending. As soon as the film premiered at the Full Frame Film Festival in April of 2013, literally that evening, we got one partner that brought a very significant grant, the biggest grant we got for the project. There was another partner that we met through something called Good Pitch, which is a program between BritDocs and Sundance. They do these pitches around the world. You bring five films together and their filmmaking teams, and you bring them into a theater or an arena, and everyone in the crowd is a funder or a foundation or a broadcaster or somebody that might be interested in your project. And we got a very large grant that came out of Good Pitch as well. So yeah, I mean, it was a squeaker. I don't know how else to say it. It was really hard to get this film done. But we made it and we love it, so it was worth it.
Going back to wordplay, do you think that you could duplicate that success again theatrically? And what do you see in the next 5 years? It just seems like tougher and tougher now that everyone's, you know, filmmaking is pretty much open to everybody.
Yeah.
There's that many more eyeballs, you know,
yeah,
being taken away from stuff. Is this something that's easily, and I'm stumbling for words here, but could you duplicate
this? Could we do
this
it again? Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, wordplay was very special. You know, we went off to Sundance that year, hopefuls, and we came out filmmakers with a really successful film. It did very well. It was within the top 25 highest box office of all time for documentaries. Got great reviews. We won a little Golden Tomato from Rotten Tomatoes. We were the best reviewed documentary of the year. I mean, it was like kind of everything kind of went right with that film. And you know, the thing is, that was almost 10 years ago, and the landscape has changed dramatically. But that said, I think that anyone could do this again. I mean, the key changes that have happened at least in the documentary landscape, but I think this is also true of narratives. A lot more people are making films, but it's still pretty hard to make a really good film. It just because there's a lot of cameras in the world doesn't mean there's going to be a lot of great movies in the world. I mean, I think there is more great work being done, but the obstacles, you know, that stand before a filmmaker who's hoping to make a really, really good film are still really high. It's hard to do that. It's hard to accomplish that. You know, I think if we really wanted to make a movie that could sell for a lot of money and find a really, really big audience, I think we could do that again. It's not impossible. That's also not necessarily what we're aiming for with our work. I mean, if we're getting paid to make our films and we make a great film, that's way more important to us than a big splashy sale at Sundance or somewhere else. I mean, truly. In fact, the reason we made If You Build It, which is a fairly small story in a small town in North Carolina, no one in the movie is well known or famous. We knew going in, like, this is not going to be wordplay. This is not going to be IOUSA, which was a nonpartisan look at the national debt that had people like Warren Buffett was in the film, several Treasury secretaries, several chairmen of the Federal Reserve. I mean, there were like a lot of kind of famous people in that movie as well. And this was different, and it was like a different mountain for us to climb, which is part of the reason we did it. But yeah, I mean, we're working on a project now. It's too early to really talk about it yet, but I mean, we're working on a project now that I think could have a much bigger audience than wordplay. So we'll see. That's probably 2 years away. So we'll see if we get there.
Now, Patrick, I heard you say in another interview that there's kind of a few people that come out of film school. There's those that say, "Oh, I only want to direct," and they're like a 24-year-old kid, and that's a problem itself. But I want to talk about another problem because you said there's people who work as camera people or editors that, boom, they find jobs right away. But then a new dilemma comes, and that is they're paid well, and then they get trapped with obligations, a lifestyle, and how do they make that passion project, or how do they leverage all that into making this next great film that they envision want? And that's their whole reason for coming to LA or New York and going to film school. So are there these, is it only the starving artists and the weekend warriors that can actually do this? Or is there a middle ground somehow?
That can, you mean actually do this by, you mean like make a film? Or when you say do this.
Yeah, sorry, I don't mean to be so vague. Yeah, I mean make a film and have it make some type of return. Because you do get trapped, you get those the good paying job, and then you spend more money and you want a nice lifestyle. It's understandable.
I would say that if making your own films is important to you gotta keep that dream alive. As horribly hokey as that sounds, it's really true. I didn't come out, I grew up in Chicago. I did not move to Los Angeles to make corporate videos. I did not come here to shoot reality television. I did not come here to light low budget movies, which all of which I've done in my sort of early career. but I realized, I went to the American Film Institute. I got out of school. I came out about 20 years ago. I've been in LA almost 20 years now. For me, job number one was just being able to afford to stay out here, paying my student loans, paying my rent, paying my insurance. Like, I was on my own. I had to figure out how to do those things. And so I started as an electrician and a best boy and a gaffer, and did that for about 3 years. Met a lot of people, learned a ton, figured out my way around town, figured out my way around this industry. Then I went back to shooting, and I said, I'm not going to do any more lighting. I'm just going to shoot as much as I can. I did that for another probably 8 years, I would say. In the meantime, while all this was happening, Christine and I got married. We bought a house. We had started our family, which were all things that I was not willing to sacrifice for my film career. I mean, I wanted to have a life too. Right around 2004, 2005, Christine and I were in our 30s. We had built a life together that we really loved, and we kind of said, this is it. This is the moment. Like, we're at a fork in the road. Either we're going to keep going down this road and make other people's TV shows and movies, or we're going to just pull the plug and just make our own stuff from here on out. And that's what we did. And that was when we started making our first film, Wordplay. And I really admire the moxie of a 22-year-old film school graduate who only wants to direct and only wants to make movies. And if they can do that, terrific. Once or twice in a generation, a Steven Spielberg is going to come around, a Steven Soderbergh is going to come around, a Paul Thomas Anderson is going to come around. And these are people who all really made great films in their 20s. But then there's the rest of us. And the rest of us have to figure out a way to make a living. And you also have to really work at your craft. So I think that studying any sort of discipline within film school is very, very valuable. In my own experience, I've seen that studying camera, which is what I studied cinematography at the American Film Institute, or studying editing are two really good places to begin, because those are the kinds of jobs that production companies need to hire all the time. They need grips, electrics, and camera ACs. That's what camera folks are good at. And they always need editors. And I have found, at least at AFI, that the people who study directing, the people who study screenwriting, those are a little tougher to break in on. Because not many people want to hire a 25-year-old screenwriter or a 25-year-old director. By the way, I would put production design in that camp also of people who can get hired pretty quickly, because production departments have very big teams. One of my roommates in film school was a guy named Todd Chernowski, who's just really one of the best art directors in Hollywood. And he was working from the day he got out of school and hasn't stopped working since. I don't know, I hope that answers your question, but I don't, the last thing I want to do is sort of discourage someone or make them feel like it's harder than it's going to be. But I think the bottom line is, if you want to have a good career, I think you have to be patient. Mm-hmm. I think you have to wait for the right moment in your life where you have a little bit of financial stability and you have, more importantly, you have confidence in your own abilities to tell a story. And when that moment happens, that's when I think you should really strike and try to make your first film, make your first television pilot, make your first, you know, whatever it is. I think that's a good moment in your life to really break out on your own. And I'll tell you, one thing that I've noticed, because I'm weird like this, but the more I've studied other filmmakers, the more I've seen, it's amazing. Overwhelmingly, the first time filmmakers tend to be in their mid to late 30s. I've seen that over and over and over and over again. I mean, I remember reading about Martin Scorsese. When he turned 30, I don't think he had made his first film yet, and he was like devastated, like, oh my God, I'm washed up at 30. But a few years later, he started and he's done fine.
Yeah, so, I think he's gonna be okay.
He'll be fine, yeah. So, anyways.
Advice to those fork in the road folks that they've built up some stability in their lives, they've built up a few years so they have some life experience, but they also know they have some obligations. Mm-hmm. What's sort of a little checklist? And I don't think you're being discouraging at all. I think you're actually being quite encouraging, because I mean, life's expensive, things cost money, but at the same time, knowing that you also want to live a life that's fulfilling.
Right.
So what would you tell? Let's suppose there's a fork in the road couple right now and you're just meeting them for coffee. What would you tell them?
I've had this conversation many times, and whenever I'm sitting at someone who's sort of standing between where they are now and their first film or their first passion project, you know, I don't want to limit it just to films, because for a lot of people, maybe it's writing their first screenplay, maybe it's producing their first television pilot, or any number of sort of ambitious projects, not just feature-length films. There's that expression, go big or go home. I think you should go small or go home. On your first project, do something that is not so ambitious that you're not gonna make it to the finish line. Because the only thing worse than a film that's not, you know, that's maybe not as successful as the filmmaker had hoped, is a film that doesn't get finished. I mean, that's just, the thought of that like rips my heart out. You know, you get a film that's halfway done and then you walk away from it. Or a screenplay that's 2/3 of the way done and they didn't quite finish for whatever reason. Whew. I mean, that's, if you're gonna really take that leap, do something that you know you have the ability to finish. You need to have a great story that you love, that you're in love with. you need to have the technical chops to see it through to the end. You need partners. If you don't have all the funding or all the pieces that are important, make sure you have them. And maybe most importantly is you need friends and colleagues who are willing to look at early cuts or read early versions of a screenplay and tell you if it's any good or not. I mean, that's really important. We had all those things when we made our first film. And probably more important than anything, my brother and my best friend encouraged us to take that leap and said, look, we have a little bit of money. We can lend you some money to get the ball rolling, which they did. And that was tremendously helpful. We paid them back. I wrote my brother a check for $100,000 after we sold Wordplay, which was really felt great. That's cool. And I think the last thing, I mean, the one other thing I would encourage people to do is to really constrain themselves. Give yourself a time limit, give yourself some deadlines, and work within them. So when we started Wordplay, the star of that film is a man named Will Shortz, who's the editor of the New York Times crossword puzzle. And we pitched our idea to him. I called the New York Times and left him a voicemail, and he called me back. That was the beginning of that film. But I told him what we had in mind, and he said to me, he said, this sounds really fun. And I just want to tell you, there's a team that's 3 or 4 years into making this very same sort of project, but they're not done yet. And I don't know, haven't heard from them in a while. I don't know where they are on this. He said, so the one thing I would ask you is, if you're going to make this movie, I'd like it to be done in a year. Because then, you know, it's not too much work on him, and we'll create some momentum, and we won't stop till we finish it. A year after we had that conversation, we were together at Sundance with the film. And that's really important. When I hear that a film is 6 or 7 or 8 years in the making, unless it's Hoop Dreams or Ken Burns' The Civil War or something, an epic film.
Sherman's March.
Sure. If it's something that's just a giant film that needs all that time, great. More power to you. Most films are not like that. And once you lose that momentum, it's really hard to get it back. It's like going on a road trip and stopping every 10 miles. I mean, eventually you're just going to turn around and go back. I did a program with Sundance where a bunch of filmmakers traveled to China and met other Chinese filmmakers, and we spent a week together, and it was really wonderful. And I was really surprised to hear that Joe Beeney, who's Werner Herzog's editor, they've done 20 films together. Joe told me that Werner is the fastest filmmaker he knows. I mean, they cut movies in like 6 weeks, maybe 8 weeks, sometimes a little longer. But I mean, they're fast. And Werner is not interested in spending 2 years in the edit room. You know, Joe's an amazing editor, Werner's an amazing storyteller. They get together, they bang it out, and they move on. And I think that that's, you know, that's an important, yeah, you know, that's a very important ingredient if you want to be productive and you want to make a lot of these kinds of movies.
Well, aside from money, what do you think it is that people hem and haw? Is it fear of getting something out there because it's not perfect?
You mean like sort of what keeps people from taking that leap and
doing it so fast? I mean, again, aside from money, which is a huge factor. So
sure.
Let's say money's not a problem or they're doing it themselves. What is it that keeps people kind of tied to it and just not releasing it?
Yeah, I mean, I think once people start making their film, their first film, you know, you got to pay the bills. You got to buy the groceries. You have to sort of support yourself while you're doing it, which is challenging. But I think a bigger hurdle is fear. I think that people are afraid that what they're doing is not good enough. And here's the dirty little secret. Every filmmaker is deep down very afraid on opening night. Maybe it worked, maybe it didn't. You're so close to the material by then that it's possible to know if it worked or not. I'm constantly amazed at how many classic films I've heard about where opening night, everyone thought the movie was a bomb. Jaws is a very good example. Richard Dreyfuss was quoted in several articles about, God, this movie took forever to make, and this young director, and I don't know what we have here. You know, and he stormed out of the theater opening night saying, he did it. He did it. It's a miracle. This movie is unbelievable. And I'm sure that 2 hours earlier, Steven Spielberg was sitting there wondering if he was going to have a career or not. You know, these things are hard to make. It's hard to make a movie, and it's hard to tell a good story. So put those two together and, you know, welcome to show business. That's really what this is about. And again, I feel like if you're surrounded by people you trust and you have a good team, a good small team, you should make your film as well as you can, as quickly as you can. Have a couple of screenings with 6 or 8 people who come over and give you honest feedback. Address those notes and get it out there, you know. It's one of those things where you only get good at it if you practice at it, and you just have to keep practicing. I think that's how you get good.
Of the films that you have made, which one taught you the greatest lesson, and what was that lesson? Maybe it was an accidental lesson.
Yeah. Well,
by chance.
You know, Christine and I have done a lot of work together. But we've only made 3 films. And I think our films are sort of special in a way, because they take a long time to make. They tend to probably maybe have a higher profile than some of the television shows we've done or commercials we've done or things like that, other projects we've done. So I think within our 3 films, I mean, they're all very different. They're like our 3 kids. I mean, they're very different from each other. I think they've all taught us lessons. I think Wordplay really taught us that we could do this, you know, that we found a story that was interesting to us. That story also had a really big built-in passionate audience. Will Shortz has millions of fans around the world. We knew that about him. So in a way, that was the odds were stacked in our favor, I think, when we started making that film. It hadn't been done before, and we found an audience. So that was great, and that gave us a lot of confidence. I think with IOUSA, which was our 2nd film, which also premiered at Sundance, that was in 2008, it's just a very different film. It was a movie about economics. It was a nonpartisan look at the national debt. I think with that film, I just had a natural curiosity. You know, economics and finance and politics are all things that I'm interested in. I'm certainly not an expert in those areas, but I got a chance to speak to really some of the greatest minds of our time about economics and about the federal government and it's the way it uses the national debt. And I mean, I love that film. I really loved making it, and I loved sharing it with people. So that was sort of the key to that one. I think as far as If You Build It was almost like a back to the drawing board moment for us. It was so hard to make. It took longer to make that movie than our first 2 films combined. And it was a tricky story. I mean, the story was hard. There were 2 teachers and 10 students and a lot of people in this town. They were all really important to the story. That's hard to cut. I mean, that's hard to cut that together. With all of these films, you're telling a story that hasn't happened yet. So in the case of If You Build It, we spent one school year with these kids. How do you know who's going to be important at the end of the story when you start? You don't. So you got to shoot. You got to shoot everybody. You got to do all their stories. You got to do all their backgrounds. And then as the year progresses, certain characters become more important. But you need footage from them at the beginning. It was hard. I mean, it was hard to do that film. But I think If You Build It kind of taught us that, not to get too confident. Like, we don't have it all figured out. You know, it's challenging to make these, no matter how much experience you have, no matter how much good fortune you've had. I think with If You Build It, even though it was really hard, I love this film. I mean, it really kind of had a very profound impact on Christina and I, because our three kids are in public schools. And we're always wondering, well, how do we, as parents, how do we make this school better than it already is? And a lot of what we learned in If You Build It, we've applied to our own school. I think I mentioned we started a kids film festival at our local grammar school. My oldest daughter, Fiona, and I decided, why don't we do a film festival? We started it last year. We just had the second one recently. That was a great way to do something with the kids that sort of speaks to the community. I mean, there's a lot of filmmakers that live in LA and live in our neighborhood. So their kids got to make movies like their parents do. And the kids love it. You know, the kids make the movies themselves, and then we show them all in the auditorium. It's great. So, I mean, every film is different. It's you get a little exhausted while you're making it, and then you release the film and you share it with others, and then eventually you get to a point where you start to get hungry again and you want to dive back in.
Well, you talked about the film being about problem solving. Mm-hmm. I think, how did you learn how to be a better problem solver? Because mm-hmm. I think we get such a narrow focus, yeah, whatever it is in our life, and especially if it's our film and we're seeing it on a timeline. How did it teach you to be a better problem solver?
Well, you know, our film, If You Build It, is about, it's really about what we call design thinking, which is, these two teachers came into a small town, a small high school in North Carolina, and they were asked to teach the students how to become more creative problem solvers, or how to learn what design thinking is and how to apply it to your own life. And design thinking is really just sort of a process by which designers and engineers and architects look at a problem. And there's sort of a structure that is involved in how to become a better design thinker. There's researching a problem. There's what we call ideating, which is throwing a bunch of ideas against the wall on yellow notepads or 3x5 cards or writing it on a whiteboard. Call that ideating. Emily calls it that. You develop an idea, which is sort of you take two or three of the best ideas and pull them together. Then you build a prototype for what that solution might look like. Maybe it's a model, maybe it's a drawing, maybe it's something like that. You refine that prototype. That's the fifth step, refine. Hmm. And then you build it. Then you take that idea of yours and you build it. And that's really rubbed off on us. So whether we're working on a film or whether we're doing something around the house, or whatever it is, like, I think sometimes people have this problem that some militaries struggle with, which is ready, fire, aim. And I think design thinking really encourages you to say ready, aim, really aim, and then fire. It's there's so many solutions in our world that have created more problems than there were before the solution was introduced. And I what we tried to show in this film is that anybody can become a better creative, a more creative problem solver. And that's what I love about the film so much. I mean, it's a really sort of an inspiring story about becoming better at what you do, whatever you do.
Patrick, where does a movie start for you?
That's a good question. Where does a movie start? I think a movie starts with just a sort of a genuine intrigue or interest in something or passion in something. Our film Wordplay, it's about the New York Times crossword puzzle. We love that puzzle. We do it all the time. I grew up in kind of a puzzle family where we did jigsaw puzzles and played Scrabble and Boggle and things like that. So that just felt very, it felt like home to me. I mean, it really did. And Will Shortz, who's the star of our film, is sort of the star of the crossword puzzle world, if you will. So that felt like a very good fit. With IOUSA, our second film, that was, you know, my brother and my brother-in-law and a lot of my very good friends from Chicago, they work in the bond trading business. They work at the Chicago Board of Trade. So I've been hearing about Alan Greenspan, and I've been hearing about the Federal Reserve and the national debt and interest rates and inflation. And I've been hearing about all those things for a very, very long time from my friends and family. But I didn't really have a clear understanding of any of that, frankly. So when the idea of making this film came up, it felt like a way to kind of catch up with my friends and my family and to be able to certainly rely on them for a lot of advice and help as we made the film, and also to sort of make a movie about their world, which we did, and really, really enjoyed it. So again, that felt like a good fit. And with If You Build It, really, I mean, the reason that film got made is that a very good friend of ours brought that idea to us. Our friend Neil Baer, who was a writer and showrunner at the show ER, and then he went on to become the head writer and showrunner at Law & Order SVU. He's currently the showrunner of a show called Under the Dome, which is on CBS. Neil's just incredibly successful. He's a wonderful person and a very, very intelligent, very kind person. Emily Pilatin, the star of If You Build It, had written a book that he loved, and he brought this idea to us, and Christine and I loved it too. In fact, almost instantly, this idea of, you know, creative problem solving and design and architecture, take all that and put it into a high school, see what happens. Like, to us, almost immediately, we're like, okay, so this is kind of like This Old House, that TV show, which I loved, and The Breakfast Club. It's like a mashup of those two ideas. So we're like, well, that's cool. That could be really fun. And in a way, that's kind of what our movie's about, in a way. So I think that if you can sort of see the movie before you make it, and what you see really makes sense, then you're probably about to head down the right path.
So I understand from reading your bio that you were one of the youngest people on the crew at PBS back in the day. For someone in a similar situation, they're just starting out, how would they conduct themselves? How would they manage other people's expectations and also other people's egos? Because, you know, there's going to be older people that may resist them or feel threatened.
Yeah. Well, I started, I got out of college 25 years ago. And I was really lucky to find a television show called The 90s, which was a documentary series that was based out of WTTW in Chicago, but it was a national television show, so it had a very big audience. And I was lucky to get in on the ground floor there. There were only about, gosh, there were only about three or four other people making that show when I started. And so I was 22, and this was a really important moment within documentary filmmaking, because Hi-8 cameras had just come out then, and Hi-8 cameras, the quality of that format was much better than VHS format. Like, there had been like camcorders that shot VHS. They'd been around for a while, but the quality of those was really pretty low. But Hi-8 was an affordable and really high quality format. And that's kind of when I started. And so a month or two after starting at that show, I bought my own Hi-8 camera. And so, you know, 10 years earlier, even 5 years earlier, in order to start shooting for PBS, you'd have to have a lot of experience. You might have to be in a union. You know, you'd have to be older, quite frankly. And I started shooting for that show when I was 22. And so I would go out and shoot something on a Monday, and Saturday night it was on PBS. And that's pretty unusual. That was, I think nowadays, maybe that doesn't seem so strange, because so many people have cameras and access to distribution is different than it was then. But to be on one of the three or four networks, four or five networks at the time, and to be that young, I was really pretty fortunate. And I think for me, I was just lucky. I was working with people who I liked, and they gave me a chance to, you know, to take a swing. And I just remember, really at the time, remember thinking, you know, this is an amazing opportunity. I literally, for a couple of years, I had that camera in my hand almost anywhere I went. I mean, I carried my camera with me all the time. If I saw something that was interesting or someone I wanted to interview, I had my camera with me and I would start shooting. So I think that, you know, knowing what you want to do and having a love for this, in my case, it's documentary films, you know, knowing that is step one. And then step two is just find a good group of people to get in with early, or do it with your friends. It's really, you know, there's two types of people that I've met who really want to do well in the film business. There's people who want like the fame and fortune. They usually don't do that well. There's the other group, which is the group that just really loves movies and loves telling stories and loves the collaboration of doing this with people that you like, doing it with your friends. Those are the people that tend to really do well, you know, because they love it for the right reasons.
So what would you say to, let's say, a 22-year-old man or woman who's new in the industry and wants to do well? I mean, without sounding too jaded, not everybody's a mentor in an environment, and sometimes you're in work environments that aren't that collaborative.
Right.
But you still need the job, you still want the experience, it's great on the resume. How does someone survive?
I think for 22-year-old kids who are starting out, or even younger, who are starting out and want to get in to the film and television business, number one is know what you love. Like, if you love musicals, watch as many musicals as you can. Start to put the names to the work. Start to really figure out. I mean, there are people behind that work. Figure out who they are. Find them. Or find people who know them or work with them, or people who are doing work like them. Okay? Musicals is a fairly specific genre, but maybe it's animation. Maybe it's television news. Maybe it's documentaries, maybe it's big Hollywood productions, whatever that is. Pinpoint who your heroes are. And if you're not able to work with them, you should be able to find work that's like the work that they do. That's number one. Number two, this is a very important rule, don't work with a jerk. if you're working with someone and they're lame, bail on them. Like, I quit. Goodbye. And turn and walk out the door. Because life is too short to work for someone who's mean or, you know, really impatient, is not willing to share their knowledge. Maybe they're insecure in their own abilities and they don't, they're too busy trying to figure out how they want to get ahead to stop and help somebody else try to get ahead. So, I mean, you know it when you see it, you know. But at the same time, if you find someone whose work you admire and they're willing to sort of help you and mentor you, do whatever you can to keep that job or to keep that position. My first year at PBS, I was an intern. I mean, I had already graduated from college. I was an intern for the first 6 months, and they were not able to pay me, but I loved working there. So I got a job at night. I worked in a restaurant 5 nights a week, and then during the day I worked for PBS. And, you know, eventually they hired me, and they knew they weren't going to get rid of me, so they had to hire me. And then I was there about 3 years, and then I went to grad school and went to the American Film Institute and studied there as well. Just got to keep at it. Don't let one person, you know, don't let one bad experience, one bad project, one bad anything slow you down. Because, you know, the film business is unlike most careers. If you start out when you're 20, you could have a 50 to 60 year career. It's a long time. You know, filmmakers oftentimes I think are like a good bottle of wine. I mean, they get better with age. Compare that to, say, like a professional athlete. Most of them are wrapped, you know, they're washed up with that career before they hit 30. They may go on to do other great things, but that's a really short career. Filmmaking and storytelling more and more is a real professional pursuit. The world needs great storytellers, and it's something that you can do almost until the day you drop. So it's you have to be patient. Just hang in there.
Your thoughts on collaboration?
Yeah, I would say that the biggest thing Christine and I have learned recently is the value of a good partnership or partnerships. If you want to make a documentary film, for example, it's really difficult to make that all by yourself. They take a long time to make. They usually take quite a bit of money. You know, it's almost like running an ultra marathon with one foot instead of two. I mean, you really have to have, you have to have partners. And the partnerships don't necessarily have to be financial partnerships. If you're making a film that is telling a very specific story, like on our current film, our current film, If You Build It, is a year in the life of one of America's most innovative classrooms. Well, there's a lot of groups around education, around design and architecture, which is a big theme in our film, rural development, sustainable business models, et cetera, et cetera. I mean, there's a lot of people in that space. So it's really important to understand the story you're telling and then to be able to explain to people the story that you're telling. Because if there's a really good fit, then you're bringing something really valuable to the table. You're about to make a movie that illustrates the mission that this nonprofit is on, or this foundation, or this whatever. And you should partner up. I think the biggest pitfall that partnerships fall into is they get all lawyered up front, and they do these very thick, very onerous kinds of agreements with each other. I mean, I would never go into a partnership with anybody if we couldn't put our terms down on one sheet of paper in plain English. I think it's important, if you're doing a partnership, to have a clear understanding of what each other wants. I think it's important also, it may be important in some cases to go into a formal sort of contract agreement. but keep it simple. Somebody hands me a 42-page contract, there's no way first of all, I'm not going to read it. Second of all, I'm not going to sign it. And third of all, I'm going to move on, because that's not a partner I want to get into bed with on a project.
What does that say about someone?
They got, you know, their priorities, I think, in the wrong place.
Somebody hands me
a contract that's that thick. And we've had some that were really tricky and created lots of problems. I think what happens is if you get a contract like that, you're dealing with someone or a group that doesn't understand the creative process. If I'm making a movie and you want to help me make that movie, and there's an overlap between what I'm doing and what you're doing, you should be able to put that down on a piece of paper in 100 words or less and figure out if there's a good fit and then move forward. You should also give yourself an out. If this doesn't work for whatever reason, I'm out. If you don't hold up your end of the bargain, I'm out. You know, these films are, the budgets on these documentaries are so tight that you cannot really afford to spend a lot of money on contracts. And I think for some reason people do that. We have an amazing lawyer named Lisa Califf. She's one of the best attorneys working in nonfiction, and we work with her all the time. But I think she would also agree that these kinds of partnerships, I think the best kinds of partnerships that I've had in my career are handshake partnerships. It's not 10 lawyers on each side partnerships. Those are usually not very successful.
Well, you had said earlier you have this thing amongst your group that the best idea wins.
Yeah.
So then when you have this huge agreement, it almost sounds like it's so much control from the other party that's not going to be open.
You can't even understand what you're agreeing to. So, yeah, I think that's a really kind of a problem.
So that's a red flag?
Yeah, yeah.
Because I think it's hard to know, you know, up front, unless you've known these people for years and you've mentioned people that you've known for years and you trust them. But for someone who's new, they're not going to know. And there's not, you know, sometimes there's red flags that you go back to and you look at later and you say, okay, I realize that was probably a sign right there that I should have said this isn't going to work.
Well, like I said, if you are going to sign a contract with someone who's a partner or going to help you make a project, let's say, what's your out clause? How do you get out?
Right.
Because if you don't have an out clause, then you're, you know, it might become like prison, like you're stuck and you can't get out. So you really have to understand that. And again, like, I think for the filmmakers who are watching, you know, you should understand that of all the people on the team, the filmmakers are going to spend way more time and energy telling the story than the financiers, the broadcast partners, the nonprofits, you name it. And so you should be confident in knowing that whatever is important to you in order to tell the story is important. And you should also be confident in your ability, because if you're in a room with 9 other partners and they all have certain needs and wants, but you're the filmmaker, you're the most important member of that partnership. The movie cannot be made without you. So know that going in and be confident in what your contribution is going to be.
And also to the subject. You may have said that and I just...
Yeah, I mean, the subjects are very much our partners in what we do. And, you know, you do form a partnership with the people who are in your films. Not a financial partnership. We've never paid anyone to appear in our films, nor will we ever do that. I think that can create a real problem. But in the same way that I wouldn't hand one of our subjects a really thick release form, I wouldn't want one of my partners to hand that to me either. I want to be able to have a conversation about what we're all trying to achieve and then go from there. I think that's a better way to start. It's a little bit like, you know, on your first date, you're doing blood tests and talking about what you're going to wear at your wedding and credit checks. It's like, well, wait a minute, we're not there yet.
Top five documentary films that every aspiring filmmaker should watch.
Wow. I'm going to make a few friends with this list and a lot of enemies.
Uh-oh.
Just because I know a lot of these filmmakers.
We could do the top 100 later. we'll get that.
I think for people who are interested in making documentary films or working in documentaries, I mean, this is completely subjective, but the films that I go back to all the time and that really inspire me, no matter how many times I've seen them, I really loved The Civil War by Ken Burns, and I met him when that film was released back in 1991. right when it was broadcast on PBS, I met him at a screening and saw one of the episodes, one of the acts of that film. I think it was like an hour long. And that was amazing. The Civil War is either 9 or 13 hours long. I mean, it's a long film, but each episode sort of almost stands alone. So I would really watch that and see what he did with a story where none of the subjects are alive anymore. Most of those stories have sort of died in some way, or have been passed on several times. I mean, what he did with that film is really a landmark achievement. I loved Hoop Dreams, still do. I'm from Chicago, that's where they made that film. I was starting my career in Chicago as they were making that film, and I actually was at their production headquarters, Kartemkin's headquarters, one day while they were in production, and saw all of the tapes that they were shooting to make that film. There were like 800 tapes in a room about this big, you know, floor to ceiling, all labeled with the dates on the side. I mean, it was just like horrifying. It was just like, what is this? And my friend's like, this is a movie called Hoop Dreams. It's gonna be great. You know, it's an amazing film, but also I think it sort of feels like home. That's where I grew up. So I love that. I love The Fog of War. I love Errol Morris's film, The Fog of War. He sat down Robert McNamara for about 4 days and did about 12 hours worth of interviews with him. And he caught Robert McNamara, who was the Secretary of Defense during the Vietnam War. He caught Robert McNamara at a moment in his life where I think he sort of wanted to just be honest and lay all his cards on the table, sort of have a mea culpa. And it's really a study in interviewing, how to interview people really well. So I just love that film. I think Man on Wire was terrific, and I liked that they relied really heavily on recreations, which I didn't really love that much. I think I was sort of resistant to recreations within documentary films. And yet James did just an unbelievable job doing recreations that sort of fit very elegantly with the archival footage. It's just a great, great movie. It's also funny because it's one of those rare films where you know the ending. You know the ending when you start watching the film. The ending is on the poster. I mean, it's, I don't want to give anything away, but I mean, you know where the movie's going, and yet it's a wonderful ride. So I just love that. And then the final film, you know, I love this movie called The Invisible War, which is done by Kirby Dick, who doesn't live very far from here. Our friend Doug Blush and Derek Boonstra, both friends of ours, edited that film. It was nominated for an Academy Award in 2013. What I love about that film, it's a great story. It's about a very difficult subject, which is rape in the military and how the military handles these cases. or really mishandles these cases. And what I love about that film is that it's really a study in the impact of storytelling, the impact of documentary films. I mean, Kirby and Doug and Derek and their team of about five or six people made their film about a mile from here in a small house. I mean, talk about a small, tiny little band of Davids, if you will. And the bad guy in this film is the U.S. military, the most powerful organization on the planet by far. And they took them down. They told a story, a beautiful story, beautiful and very heartbreaking story, about women and men who had been sexually abused in the military, and the sort of mistreatment that they got, the injustice that they got in return when they tried to blow the whistle on what had happened to them. And so they make this film. They get accepted to Sundance. It screens at Sundance. It becomes this sensation, this movie that everyone needs to see. And then something really unbelievable happened, which is Leon Panetta, the Secretary of Defense at the time, saw the film on Air Force One. They landed. He called a press conference and he said, "I've just seen a film called The Invisible War. And we are going to start doing things differently in our military. This cannot go on any further." And they've made great strides. They could probably do more. Hopefully they will. But they really changed the way that they investigate these kinds of cases. They changed the way that they punish these criminals who are sexually abusing people in their own ranks. That's the power of filmmaking. It's the power of really good documentary filmmaking. And I think that's a good number five for us.
You know, you'd said earlier that you'd like to go into a film's idea and subject without a real bias to it. Mm-hmm. How do you feel about filmmaking as a form of activism?
I think it's great. I mean, I think that people make documentary films for different reasons. And some people make them because they see a real problem in the world, a real injustice in the world, and they go out and they try to advocate against it, and they try to change the way things are. I mean, that's very, very common within the documentary filmmaking ranks. And I feel that's great. If that's what people want to do, that's what they should do. For me, and I think documentary film advocacy certainly is important. I think where some of these films sometimes lose their way is that people are either only preaching to the choir, which I think has limited sort of effect. It sort of doesn't really change anything. And I also would really draw the line on, on people who are sort of fast and loose with the truths of a story. I think it's really important, if you're trying to make a case, to be as transparent and as honest as you can be. If in telling your story you become dishonest or are telling half-truths, then maybe your argument is not as strong as you think it is. You know, you should be able to lay out the facts and present your argument in a very honest and compelling way. And I think that's how you make an effective, impactful documentary film. Some people don't always do that, and I have really strong feelings against that approach, because, you know, that's just more misinformation. More sort of shading of the truths, or more deceitfulness, which I don't think is the way to go. One of the things I love about Jon Stewart's show, The Daily Show, is they just hammer you with the truth. They just win their arguments based on truth and fact and good humor. You know, Mark Twain was the same way. If you're winning all your arguments by lying to people or by not presenting the whole story, that's, I think audiences are really getting smarter than ever, and they catch on to that quickly, and your film ends up losing a lot of integrity.